putting off the old man and putting on the new man, please write them down. Very useful references for you to know. I wrote them down, that's why I thought I should share it with you all. You're welcome to take out your phones and for these 2 seconds take a picture of it and then turn your phone back off. But yeah, please, these are very useful references to know. And we didn't put the verse, by the way, there's a reason we don't intend, we intentionally do not put Bible verses up there during the service when we're teaching. It's one thing when we say our memory verse together. But when we're teaching, we are very intentional about not putting the actual verse up there, the text of the verse, because we want to, us all to get in the habit of bringing our Bibles to church and knowing, to the church meetings, and knowing, seeing it here. It's quite a different thing when you see it up there. It's a little bit disconnected. I find it becomes a lot more personal when you have it and you hold it, you see it in its context, and you kind of remember where to find it later on when you go home, because this slide is not going to be with you at home when you need it. That's when you really need the verse, the sword of the Spirit, the most. So little exercises in helping us make the sword of the Spirit that God has given us personal. It would be an ineffective soldier who went into battle and knew that there were swords but didn't know how to use it. And when they went out into battle, got into the battlefield and realized, oh man, I was supposed to bring my sword, left it back at camp. He would not last very long, and he would be certainly ineffective. So that's why it's good for us to be students of the word, diligent, take it seriously, and to make it personal. I'd like to continue, and I believe this, I think this will be the last part, part three of my messages on spiritual authority. And I'd like to, before I begin on what I'd like to share today, give you a little bit of a recap of what we've seen so far, what I've talked about in the context of spiritual authority. So on that next slide, I'll show you that first we looked at the fact that Jesus had spiritual authority. And in that verse in John 5, you can look at it later on, you'll see that the reason the Jews and the Pharisees sent Jesus to the cross was because of the authority he had. They were angered by the fact that he was exercising spiritual authority, and they weren't used, they with their pomp and celebration and their loving the high places and loving the titles and loving the respect and honor of the people in Israel, didn't take kindly to the fact that along came this lousy carpenter whose mother we know but father we don't, at least that's what they thought, who showed them up because he had spiritual authority. And that's what angered them the most. It's what angers the devil as well. If you're interested in living a life where you don't bother the devil, he won't bother you. But I hope that that's not the life you want to live. I hope that you are not content to live a life on this earth where you stay out of the devil's territory so that he'll stay out of yours. See, Jesus came here to destroy the works of darkness. That means he went around finding where the devil's territory was, and he said, that's mine, and that's mine, and that's mine. My dear brothers and sisters, if we are to be the church, and we are the church, we are truly the church following in the footsteps of Jesus, if we are living our lives on this earth in the same way, not afraid of the devil, but going around finding out where does the devil have a foothold, somewhere where God has placed me and given me responsibility. Is it in your marriage? Is it in your home? Is it in your neighborhood? Is it in your workplace? Is it in the grocery store where you go? And you may not even know the extent to which the devil has authority in people that you interact with. But God has taken you there and placed us there. And he's placed us, like I said earlier, he's placed us as a church very intentionally here in Loveland to exercise spiritual authority. That the people who are sitting in darkness will see a light, a true light. And that's not by just the preaching and the fellowship and our gatherings. It's by every single one of us taking that responsibility seriously to say, Lord, you placed me on this earth to exercise spiritual authority, to take down the gates of hell, to find the gates of hell and to take them down. And I love that picture that Olu gave us earlier. We're not struggling here. We're not lying on the ground with the devil's foot on top of our neck, just like waiting for him to get his foot off of our neck. If that's been your testimony and your life, my dear brother, dear sister, let's study God's word again. Let's go back and devote ourselves to prayer. Let's devote ourselves to falling on our face before God and asking him to show us the reality. Because perhaps what you're watching is a movie in which the devil has his foot on your neck. But that's just a movie. The reality is you are with your foot over the devil. We have authority over the devil. Now, it's not just we say we have authority and we live pretending that we have authority. We must really have authority. Jesus actually had authority. And because he had that spiritual authority, now, you may be able to fool the world. You may be able to fool people in this world whether you have spiritual authority or not. For example, there are some husbands who exercise what they think of as their authority, or fathers who exercise what they think of as their authority by banging their fist on the table and saying, "This is how it is in my house. I'm the head of this house." That's authority. That's an authoritarian kind of voice, but it may not be spiritual authority. In fact, real spiritual authority doesn't have to raise its voice. It speaks very quietly, like I showed you Jesus did to Pilate, who Pilate tried to yell at him and tell him, "How dare you don't speak to me? Don't you know who I am, the ruler of this area?" And Jesus said, "I don't have to yell. I don't have to scream. I have authority. You only have authority over me to the extent to which my Father has allowed you to have." So there's a quiet reality of the authority that a true man or woman who has spiritual authority lives in. And we must have that. So we may be able to fool people on this earth, but there's two groups of people you cannot fool, and that is God himself in heaven. We know that. But you also can't fool the devil. And if you're trying to battle with an enemy where he knows you don't have spiritual authority over him, he's just going to sit back and laugh and say, "What do you mean in the name of Jesus, I have authority, you have authority over me? You don't have authority over me because I see that you're entertaining that lust in your life. Secretly, you have pride. Secretly, you speak disrespectfully and rudely to your wife or your husband or to others in your workplace. You have that bitterness or that unforgiveness." All of these things that give the devil an advantage, give him an advantage over you. And when he has the advantage over you, how are you going to say you have spiritual authority? That's like, you know, they're out there scoring the touchdown and you're saying, "We won, we won." No, the devil won because of that unforgiving attitude, because of that bitterness, because of that lust, because of that anger. And not just because it's there, but because we don't take it seriously. And we allow it to remain and we sweep it under the carpet. But that's why the devil doesn't want us to bring things into the light. There is safety in the light, church. When we bring things into the light of God, I'm not talking about public confession of sin or anything like that. I'm talking about saying, "Lord, I'm tired of sweeping this stuff under the carpet and hoping nobody will turn the light on so they see the reality of my marriage or the reality of my thought life or the reality of how I am in the workplace compared to how I am here where I'm around church folk. I hope nobody finds out. I hope nobody will show up in my workplace all of a sudden and realize, is this the same guy that sits next to me in the church meeting? He's quite a different person. I hope nobody will find that out." If we allow that hypocrisy to remain, the devil will continue to have authority over us. But that is not the life God wants us to live. So Jesus had spiritual authority. And we see both times where Jesus mentions the word church, he talks about the authority with which the church must live on this earth. That we must be exercising spiritual authority. "I have given you the keys of the kingdom," he told Peter. "On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." You will establish a church, Peter, you and the other apostles, and we're in the business of doing that, which will have authority over the devil, where we will go to the devil's city and tear it down, where he used to come to my city and tear it down. And like I said a couple of weeks ago, no longer are we just on defense. We're like always watching out for where the devil's going to hit me next. Oh, he's going to show up over there. Oh, it's Tuesday or Thursday. Where is he going to hit me next? No, because I've seen that God has placed me on this earth with a purpose to find the works of darkness, to find the gates of hell, and to take them down. And the promise is the gates of hell will not prevail. If you're living that way, my dear brother, dear sister, dear friend, with that kind of authority, where you know it's a reality in your life, You have a clear conscience before God and before people on this earth. You don't have anything that you need to set right with anybody. You haven't harmed anybody in any way, spoken to people in any way that needs to be set right. Then you have a clear conscience with people on this earth. And if there's sin that's unconfessed, you've confessed it. Immediately then, where you have that clear conscience, you can live with spiritual authority. You must live with spiritual authority. So like I say there, the only real threat to Satan's kingdom are those who have spiritual authority. And believe me, if you live this way, if we live this way as individuals, in our marriages, in our homes, and as a church, a local expression of the body of Christ, the devil will turn on the heat. He will come at us. And we've seen that happen in our church. And if you're living a godly marriage where you're determined that the devil will not have a foothold, and you're building a godly home where you're determined the devil will not have a foothold, you know he's tried to attack you, hasn't he? You know why? Because he's angered over the fact that there is even one home in Loveland where he does not have a foothold. And church, this is our business. This is our business, to establish churches in Loveland, in Thornton, in Wyoming, in Greeley, in Denver, wherever we may be, saying there will be one more home in which the devil is angry because he doesn't have a foothold. I want that to be a testimony of my life, my marriage, my home life, and this church as well. I want to talk about the basis of our having spiritual authority. I hope by now that through the Holy Spirit you have seen the importance and the value of living with spiritual authority and the confidence, the untouchability. You know, in India, there's this group of people that are the lowest caste. There's the caste system, and then there's people who are so mistreated, they're below the caste system even. They're called the untouchables. And they're called that because they won't even touch them. But there are certain people who are untouchable in the spiritual realm. And those are people who, no matter what the devil does, he can't touch them. I mean, he can do stuff to them, but he can't touch their spiritual beings because they have spiritual authority over them. We should live like untouchables, where the devil brings stuff at us. He throws stuff at us, and maybe God allows him to bring sickness into our life, and loss of money, loss of job, or loss of different prospects. But in the midst of that, you and I dwelling in the heavenlies, seated at the right hand of the Father, like he tells us in Ephesians 1, are untouchable. The real me is untouchable. It doesn't matter what he can do to my body or to my soul. Let's live in that way. In Matthew chapter 7, we read in verse 28, we've been looking at the Sermon on the Mount and the immense, intense teaching that Jesus gave to his disciples with the multitude present around him. And we read that at the end of this long sermon, I'm not sure how long it took him to say it. Maybe it took about half hour or so, if it's exactly these words as they are written. Excuse me. But at the end of it, we see in verse 28, when Jesus had finished these words, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority, not as their scribes. So what the people who were gullible, everyday people, some of them may have been intelligent, some of them maybe not, most of them were probably very poor, because those were the kind of people that were attracted to Jesus. And there were these people who didn't know up from down, heads from tails, sitting there listening to Jesus, thinking, well, we're just going to listen to another service, but there's something different about this guy. They used to go to the synagogues and listen to the Pharisees preach, and they probably fell asleep and got bored. But one day they heard about this guy who's out there preaching on the mountainside. He's not preaching in the synagogue. And they go listen to him, and they recognize something. It's like their mouth dropped open, because he had the appearance of a poor carpenter from Nazareth, a town where people say, Nazareth, what good can come out of Nazareth? And here's this man from Nazareth teaching them with such spiritual authority that they were amazed. And they recognized that he had something that the theologians and the Bible scholars and the lawyers, the experts in the law, and the scribes and the Pharisees and all these Levites and all these people that you would expect to have spiritual authority because of their position didn't have. Here was somebody just sitting on the floor like them, sitting in the chair just like them, but they would rather listen to him after the church service was over than listen to the sermon itself, because his words had authority. And I like how the, I think I brought this out last month, how the Message paraphrase brings out this verse, that Jesus, they recognized that he had authority because he was living every word he was preaching. My dear friends, this is the basis of our spiritual authority. If you and I are living out this book, if you and I are living out this book in secret where nobody knows that you are, wives, when it says, submit to your husbands as the church is submitted to Christ, and in secret where you have every right according to your intellect and according to what your friends are telling you to rebel against that authority that God has placed in your life, but you choose to obey the word of God, what does God do? Your Father who sees in secret, you know, it says in Matthew 6, your Father, our Father is watching everything that's going on. The eyes of the Lord are on this earth toward the good and to the evil. He sees it all. He sees everything that's going on, and he sees what you're doing in that secret moment of temptation. And if you choose to honor the word of God and to obey, something happens. God puts his life inside of you, inside of us, which gives us spiritual authority, which means the next time I open up my word, and you don't have to do it here behind the pulpit, you could be there and somebody asks you, what's the Lord speaking to you this week? And you say, some verse. You know what happens in that moment? Because your Father has seen the way you were living, you are living your life in secret. He backs up your words with spiritual authority. And like I said, you can't fool God and you can't fool the devil. And when you try to attack the devil knows that those words that you're speaking to him, binding the forces of darkness and loosing that which needs to be loosed, have authority. Because he knows whether God is backing up your words or not. He knows what you have done in secret. He knows, young men and older men, whether you are being faithful with your eyes, overcoming lust. He knows whether you're being faithful in the use of your tongue, in anger and gossip. And he knows whether you're being faithful in whether you love money or not in your heart. He knows all of those things. You may think you have your wife or your husband fooled and the rest of the church fooled, but you don't have the devil fooled. You don't have God fooled. And the devil, if he sees that you are being faithful in secret, and every time you get up, you fall, you get back up. I was showing Pat and I, my father and I were talking last night, and I want to show you this verse. It's a new definition for righteousness that maybe you haven't seen before. I just want to share that in passing as an aside. The characteristic of a righteous man, Proverbs chapter 24. Proverbs 24, the characteristic of a righteous man. You may be surprised at what you find in the Bible when you look a little bit more carefully. Because we have these preconceived notions that we've usually picked up from morality in the world of what righteousness looks like. The Bible's definition of a lot of these things is quite different. And one of these is here. In Proverbs 24, verse 16, we read this verse. The characteristic of a righteous man is this. A righteous man falls seven times. Whoa, what do you mean falls seven times? I thought the righteous man might, if you had asked me before I read this verse, I would have thought, the righteous man never falls. God's ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. The righteous man falls seven times and rises again. This is God's definition of righteousness. Are you standing? He doesn't ask you how many times you've fallen. He doesn't ask you how many times you made a mistake. The question is, are you standing right now? Which means if you fell seven times, you got up seven times. If you fell 70 times, you got up 70 times. If you fell 700 times, you got up 700 times. The question God asked me today to call me righteous is, are you standing today? Because it says Abraham believed God and God reckoned it to him, counted it to him, credited to him as righteousness. So when you believe God and you put your faith in God, what are you saying? You're saying, Lord, I fell again, but I'm going to get back up one more time. Because you are a good God, and you who began the good work in me are faithful to complete it. So it doesn't matter if I've spent 70 years falling, I'm going to get back up. Because I want to be standing today. And I want to be standing when Jesus Christ comes back. It says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? When I read this verse, Proverbs 24, verse 16, this is what I believe God is looking for. People who are standing, who... He's not going to ask, so how many times did you fall now? Are you one of those 700 category? Or are you the 7 million category? No. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Will he find people who stood up, even if it was the 7 billionth time? And the picture I get when I think of that is, I watch my children. I've watched all four of my children as they've learned to walk. You know, they start out, they start out, and we're very excited when they can roll over. That's a big deal for parents, especially first-time parents. But even for, even by our fourth, we were very excited. She rolled over. And then they learn to get on their haunches, and they're kind of on their knees a little bit, and they flop back down. They're more comfortable on their belly, but they slowly get back up, and then they start to crawl. And all of these things I'm watching as a father looking down from above and just excited about. And then I see that they slowly pull themselves up, and they stand holding on to something, and they're just teetering and tottering, and then they fall back down. But I've got a big smile on my face. And then they stand back up, and then they're willing to even try standing without holding on to anything. And my smile gets bigger. And then they try to take a step. And now I'm really beaming, and I'm calling Megan over. Come, watch. She's about to take another step. This is the delight our Heavenly Father gets when he sees every son or daughter of his trying to walk. And you know what happens after that? My child that's trying to take that first step is bound to fall. And you might walk into this, if you don't understand the dynamics of what's going on here, you walk into that situation and you see me and my wife with big smiles on our face right when our child falls down, and you think, what cruel parents you are. Would you laugh when your child falls down? Oh, I do. Because I know the child that is falling down is the child that is trying to walk. The child that has fallen on its face is the child that's going to get back up and try again. Now, I would get a really sad look and a disappointed look on my face if one of my children finally gave up and says, walking's not for me. Dad, Mom, it looks like you know how to run even. And you can run fast, but it's not for me. I'd say, no, don't give up. Get back up. Does it feel like you fell for the 7 millionth time? Get back up. Walking is for you. Running is for you. And this is the message for us, dear church, dear brothers, dear sisters. Running is for us. Walking is for us. We're called to triumph. We're called to overcome. We're called to exercise spiritual authority over the devil. And it has nothing, absolutely nothing to do with our past and how long we have fallen in sin and struggled in sin like Olu talked about. It's time to take up the battle call, the battle cry, and say, enough, Satan. You will not win, because I read the end of the story. So Jesus had spiritual authority. If you skip down to Matthew chapter 8, begin reading in verse 5. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him imploring him and saying, Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, fearfully tormented. Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. So Jesus, get the picture here. He's coming into the entrance of the city, Capernaum. This is the city that he would end up making his home for his 3.5 years of ministry, even though he traveled quite a bit. As he's coming into the city, a centurion who is a Roman, unconverted, ungodly, as far as we know, worshiping Roman gods. No reason to know that he is necessarily a believer in Jehovah. But somehow he had faith in Jesus, true faith. And here's Jesus coming into the town, and this centurion has a servant who is very dear to him. And he tells Jesus, Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, fearfully tormented. And Jesus said, sure, where's your house? Come, let's go. But the centurion said, Lord, I am not worthy for you to come under my roof, which is presumably some distance away, maybe the other side of town, or somewhere in the town is the centurion's house. And here's Jesus, some distance away. I am not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. Listen to this carefully. You've probably read this story. You know this story very well. But I want you to pay real close attention to what it was that Jesus highlighted in the story more than the miracle itself. There was a miracle that actually happened. This centurion's servant does get healed. But the point, the reason that's recorded in Scripture is not primarily so that we know, do you have a servant who needs to be healed? Jesus can heal him too. Yes, that's true. But there's a greater lesson that we shouldn't miss. The centurion said, Lord, I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. What is he saying? Lord, you're over here and my servant is there about 5 miles away, but I trust your power of speech. Here it goes back to authority again. It's not that Jesus is going to yell really loud so that 5 miles away in that house where the centurion's servant is sick, that servant will hear the voice of Jesus and be lifted up from his paralysis. No. This centurion recognized that Jesus had spiritual authority, and that's where the problem was. For, and then he goes on to say this, verse 9, "For I also am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another one, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it." Now when Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who were following, "You Israelites, you think you have the corner on the gospel and that you, God is on your side. Guess what? Take a moment and learn faith from this centurion, this Roman. Truly I say to you, I have not found such great faith with anyone in Israel." All of you with your Bible scholarship and prayer and sacrifice and charity and all this stuff, along comes a centurion who doesn't even know God, as far as we know, that well at least, but he's got more faith. He's able to discern what's happening in the spiritual realm and recognize the spiritual authority that Jesus had. "I say to you that many will come from east and west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of kingdom will be cast out into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." And Jesus said to the centurion, "Go, it shall be done for you as you have believed." Again, do you picture Jesus yelling, "Hey, over there, you servant in bed, get up, it's, you're healed." No. Go. He may even have whispered it. "Go, it shall be done for you as you have believed." Miles away, that servant lying on his bed is lifted up. This is spiritual authority. And the servant was healed that very moment. The servant was healed that very moment. Let's go back to see what it was that the centurion actually said. "Would you mind grabbing my orange bottle of water? Thanks. Thank you, man." So we're going to look at verse 9 again. Matthew 8, verse 9. "Lord, I'm not," this is verse 8, "I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I also," let's look at this carefully, "I also am a man under authority." He talks about being under authority first. We're going to see how Jesus has spiritual authority over things. He says, Jesus' authority to cast out the sickness, to have authority over sickness and ultimately over the devil. But he starts by saying, "I also am a man under authority." That means I have authority over me. "And I say, with soldiers under me." So here's, what's he saying is, I'm in the middle. I'm not at the bottom, but I'm not at the top either. I'm in the middle. I have authority over me, and then I have soldiers who are under me, authority under me, that I have authority over. And he's using that picture of him as a centurion in this middle of the chain of command to say, "Jesus, I see that you're also in the middle of the chain of the command." See, I think the danger, the devil would love for us to think that we're at the bottom and everything has authority over us, including the devil. And that's one extreme. That's false. That's a lie of the devil. He would also love for us to think that we're at the top. I have authority over everybody else. I don't have to submit to anybody. I'm my own man. That is also of the devil, because that's what made the highest archangel the devil. He was in the middle. This is the highest archangel. We don't know what his actual name was. We call him Lucifer now. But he was there, and he had God above him. Everything else was under him. All the angels, everything else that God had made was under this highest archangel. So he was in the middle. He had authority over him, and he had authority under him. He was in charge of all of these angels. That wasn't enough for him. He coveted this place where he wanted to be the top dog, where he was above everybody else. He wanted to be the CEO. And in that moment, the most beautiful created being who led worship in heaven became the most wicked being that has ever existed, the devil himself. In that moment, because he coveted this, "I want to be without authority. I want to be without authority over me. I want to be the boss. I don't want to have to report to anyone." So the centurion recognizes that Jesus is a man. He says, "I too am a man under authority." I too means what? I am also, which means Jesus, you also, you are one, and I'm also one. That's what he's saying. I'm a man in the middle. Jesus, you are also a man in the middle. So the centurion recognized that the reason Jesus had authority over this sickness that was miles away, where he didn't even have to yell and scream and wrestle with the sickness. Jesus didn't have to come there and put his hands even physically on the man. See, that's why I believe if you really have faith, if you really have spiritual authority, you can heal, if God gives you the gift and the calling in a particular instance, without even touching the person. Maybe Jesus proved that right here. He was too far to even reach his hands and touch. I mean, you hear about the woman who's touched the hem of his garment, and by touching his clothes, she got healed. This is an even greater miracle. Jesus spoke, and miles away, he wasn't even there to touch the bed or go anywhere near, and the servant was healed. This is spiritual authority. So this centurion recognized it. What was he saying about being under authority? See, the centurion says, when I tell my servant, go, and he goes, he could be, maybe, I don't know how tall the centurion was. Maybe, let's imagine he's about my height, 5'10". You know, not that tall, not that intimidating. That's what I mean by that. Just an ordinary guy. And he's standing in front of his slave, who's 300-pound lineman, 6'5", and he's telling servant, go. You know, get the picture. Here's the centurion who has authority over him, this ordinary man, not very intimidating, telling this big servant, in fact, looking up to him and telling him, go. And he goes. I mean, that must be a sight to see. But that's the reality. And the reason this is important for us to understand is because we deal with an enemy that loves to puff himself up and look like a 300-pound lineman and intimidate us that way. It says, what do you mean authority over me? What do you mean go? What do you mean in the name of Jesus? Don't you know I'm bigger than you? Don't you know I'm more powerful than you? But what the centurion says was he just looks at the servant, looks up to him because he's taller and bigger and says, go. And he goes. What is it that causes this centurion to obey a man who is smaller than him, with a punier voice even? He recognizes that this man, as short or small as stature as he is under the authority of Rome. Above him is a man who is over 1,000. And above him is a man who is over 10,000. And above them all is this man called Caesar, and I don't want to mess with him. Because the entire power of the Roman Empire is with Caesar, who has entrusted authority to this centurion, 5'10". Standing in front of me and telling me to go. And he recognizes what's behind. He recognizes the authority that this centurion represents and says, therefore I will go. And this is the authority, this is the basis on which you and I have authority. It's not based on how long you've been a centurion. It's not based on how long you've walked with the Lord or how good you've been or, you know, have you been naughty or nice so then you'll have authority. No, that's for the Santa Claus people. Santa Claus has will bring you gifts if you have naughty or nice, and I'm saying that in jest. I think you know me well enough to know that. But the devil is not about naughty or nice. He cares only whether you have spiritual authority, and he knows whether you have it or not. Based on what? Based on this clear conscience that I've already talked about, and faith. Based on the faith. That's why Jesus said, I have never seen such faith. Here's a man who sees it. He sees that me, poor carpenter who never went to Bible school, he's standing here, looks ordinary just like everybody else. He sees that I have spiritual authority, and he recognizes it. And he says, I've never seen such faith in all of Israel. And so this soldier looks at the centurion and says, I better not disobey the centurion, because if I disobey him, he has the powers of his boss, who has the powers of his boss, who has the powers of his boss, who has the powers of Rome at his command. This is the basis of spiritual authority. So he recognized that Jesus had spiritual authority because he was under authority. And my dear friends, I believe this is a truth that the devil wants to hide from us. He hid it from me for years. And I'll share a little bit of personal testimony now. It was this passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 8 that brought me to Loveland. This very passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 8 that I read in California. And the Lord asked me, he says, do you have spiritual authority? Are you under spiritual authority? Here I was going to a large church, more than 10,000 people in the church, fairly involved in the church at the time, living a pretty good Christian life, I thought. And the Lord convicted me and said, Santos, you lack spiritual authority. And the reason it was especially relevant for me, because I was about to get married. This is in 2005 or so. We got married in 2006. But as I sensed that I was going into this relationship where I was now responsible to give account for another human being, and we were going to build a life together, And God willing, God would give us children over whom I would need to have spiritual authority. And I said, Lord, I dare not go into this relationship. I dare not go into this next chapter of my life if I don't have spiritual authority. Let me not go on with my life thinking I have it, trying to bang my fist on the table saying, wife, you shall listen to me when I lack it. Telling my children, I'll whip you if you don't obey me. This is the kind of authority you see abused in the world today. And then there is spiritual authority, where the devil knows who is the head of the home. See, that's the most important thing. Even if your wife or your husband or your children don't know who's the head of the home, does the devil know it? See, God knows it. But does the devil know it too? Because he sees the way you live your life, the way you love husbands, the way we love our wives, as Christ loves the church and gave himself up for her. He sees that we honor God's word and they're willing to live in this humility and service to people around us, to our wives, and we live in that brokenness, and he sees it and he's afraid, because there are men in this church, because there are men in Loveland for a change that have authority, and he's afraid that he might lose a few more. And I believe he will, if we continue to exercise this kind of spiritual authority. Think about us going out now from week to week, from our Sunday services into this town of Loveland, into our neighborhoods, into our communities with that authority. And the devil's fearful. I mean, I picture him having a conference in the boardrooms of hell saying, oh man, the church is over. They're coming. They're coming to Thornton. They're coming to Littleton. They've got out of the church meeting. They've been empowered with not just a good pep talk, but they've gone on their knees and their faces before God and says, God, give me this spiritual authority so I can stand before you knowing that I deal with a defeated enemy. Lord, I want to live this way. And he sees you driving down the road on your way back home and he's trembling like a dog with his tail between his legs. I love that picture if you've read Pilgrim's Progress, where he's battling Apollyon. Christian is battling Apollyon. He's just under defeat. And one day he has his eyes opened to see in faith that he is the victor. And he takes up his sword and attacks Apollyon, and this enemy that looked so terrible runs away with his tail between his legs. He is the one that's called to run. Resist the devil, and what will he do? Oh, come on. What will he do? Flee! Yes. So, recognizing that we have spiritual authority when God gives his spiritual authority to those who are under spiritual authority, who have learned that. These words, where the multitudes recognized it about Jesus, were recorded after 30 years. It's significant. It wasn't when he was lying in a manger. Oh, what authority he has. I think he did already, but there was a proving that Jesus had to go through himself. The perfect, sinless Lamb of God had to be subject. It says in Hebrews 5, he had to learn obedience in the things that he suffered. The Father had to say, Son, You volunteered for this. Guess what? You've got to go through the same proving that everybody else in the world has to go through, which is what? Do you want to have spiritual authority? Yes, Father, I do. Then you must live under spiritual authority. I'm going to give you a father and a mother, a stepfather and a mother, who are not even born again. Because you couldn't be born again before the day of Pentecost. And they're good people. Yeah, they'll be nice to you. But they're going to make a lot of mistakes. I mean, us believers, born-again people make a lot of mistakes. Imagine what Joseph and Mary was like. I mean, Mary wasn't the saint you imagined her to be. She was a human being just like us, and she made mistakes, and so did Joseph. But there was Jesus sitting under that spiritual authority, under their authority, their delegated authority, learning spiritual authority, learning to submit, learning to humble himself, to lower himself. I mean, I picture him sitting in school in the fifth grade, or whatever it was, and the teacher in fifth grade teaching them that the earth was flat, because that's what they believed until a few hundred years ago. You know, here's the teacher telling Jesus, who made the world, you know, the earth's flat, right? And Jesus is thinking, whatever you think. He subjected himself, and I don't picture Jesus getting into an argument. He says, no, but I made the world. What do you mean the earth's flat? And then Mary tells Jesus, it's time for you to clean the toilet. This is, do you see this? Jesus, who sat on the throne for all eternity and told angels to do his work, and they worshiped him, and he was adored, and he's greater than any king that has ever lived, comes down to this earth, and his mother, another human being whom he created, tells him, go and clean the toilet, and he says, yes, mommy, I'll do that. You see the value of why we teach our children to obey our parents. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. And he doesn't ask you to do something that he himself didn't do. And if there was anybody who had a right to disobey his parents at any point in his life, it was Jesus. And yet not once did he disobey his parents. That's how he was a perfect example. If there was anybody that had the right to say, how dare you treat me like that, it was Jesus. And yet not once. He humbled himself. And like a sheep that was led to the shearers, he allowed them to mistreat them. And he was silent. And he didn't once defend himself, as far as I can read, when they accused him of being an illegitimate son. He just said, Lord, it's in your hands. You're my father. You deal with it. This is the spirit of those who have learned to subject themselves to spiritual authority, to continue my testimony. That's why I came here. There were two elders here in this church at the time. Most of you were not here. But the Lord said, come and submit yourself to the elders in this church and walk in humility and make yourself available. Don't aspire anything. I didn't know what gifts I had. I wasn't active in ministry or anything like that. But I said, Lord, you call me here. And if my responsibility in RLCF is to clean the toilets or to vacuum the floor or to be the one that opens the door, I'll do it, Lord. Just place me under spiritual authority. It doesn't matter what you use me for. I'm not here to be used. And I'll tell you honestly, my testimony, church, that is still the case today. If the Lord removes me from this pulpit and removes the gift of teaching from me and calls me to do something menial that we think of as menial, I value the church. I value my place under spiritual authority. And even as an elder in this church, I want you to know that we walk in that walk of spiritual submission to one another. Phil and I, we walk in submission to one another. Both of us seek to submit ourselves to Zach in his apostleship over us and over the church. Why? Because we recognize that the moment that we think that we are removed from having to submit in any situation, God removes our spiritual authority. The moment this spirit of rebellion steps in, where I think, I don't have to submit to anybody, I'm the elder now. If I had allowed that to happen in my heart, immediately, I could have continued to get up here and preach, and I could have continued to say all of these things, but the words would have lacked spiritual authority. Why do I give you that example? Because, my dear friends, dear church, this is the life we are all called to live. It's not just for the elders in the church. All of us have spiritual authority in different realms in which God has given us that authority. Husbands, wives, fathers, mothers, children, you too have some level of authority. Don't try to exercise it outside of that, but recognize the boundary that God has placed you. You have younger brothers. You have younger sisters whom you can care for and nurture and build up. And in order for you to do that in a way that has lasting, eternal effect, you too must have spiritual authority. Children, you can have that. Imagine if that's the kind of church we are, where every single one of us, from the youngest to the oldest, is going around saying, God, give me that spiritual authority. Now, I think this is really true about spiritual authority. When you have it, people, you won't look like you have it. I mean, you'll talk very gently. You won't walk around all of a sudden with an air about you and, you know, wearing your coat to church. Like, you won't walk around with this sense of importance. Jesus walked in such a way that they couldn't tell that he had spiritual authority, but he had it. And a few, like the centurion, discerned it. I mean, the rest of the Jews, he says, I've seen more faith in you than in all of Israel. They all missed it. They were looking for the most important person, the tallest person, like they did with Saul, remember, in the Old Testament. Oh, he was the tall guy. Yeah, he must be the one with spiritual authority. This guy, he's the most gifted. Oh, he must be the one to have spiritual authority. Oh, that other person, she needs to have spiritual authority. Look at what she can do. Look at what he can do. And the Father was looking for the ones who were willing to submit themselves completely under his mighty hand. Gave them spiritual authority. Hebrews chapter 13, I'll show you this verse that also the Lord used to bring me here. Hebrews 13, verse 17. Obey your leaders. You know, we love to teach our children, children, obey your parents in the Lord. This is an obedience, all of us. Obey. This is a good memory verse for us adults to learn. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account. You know, that's why I'm not that keen for our church to multiply and become a mega church very quickly, because I stand accountable to God for this verse, that if our church does grow very big, all of a sudden the responsibility on Phil and I grows, where we have to give account. Do you realize, church, that that's what we do when we meet and when we pray over you and when we meet with you guys here at different meetings? We have to give account. The Lord's going to ask. He asks us, how is so-and-so doing? How is that situation? How about so-and-so? How are they doing? And he says, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account. Not just now, even at the end of our lives, we'll stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Phil and I will have to give account for those who committed themselves to be a part of this church. That's why we take that seriously. We ask you, you know, those of you who have become members, we ask you to take some period of time before you decide to become members, because this is not a light thing. We have to stand before Almighty God and answer to Him. And if that's something that you're not interested in, or you're not interested in, then we don't want to force it on you. We're not interested in necessarily even filling all of the chairs that I see empty. It's not about that. But that every single one whom God gives me, like Jesus said, of all the ones whom you gave us, we have not lost any. We cared for them, Father, and we nurture them, and we give account to you for them. Let them do this with joy and not with grief, for this would be unprofitable for you. That's what the command is, very clear. Obey your leaders. Why? It will profit you. You will get the benefit in the long run if you obey your leaders and submit to them and allow them to give account for your souls with joy, where you walk in that accountability and that fellowship. And I just want to pour my heart out and say what I've said here before, and I know is the heart of Phil as well. This is the passion of our hearts as elders in this church, is to give account for you with joy and to walk alongside you and not point fingers at you or say, how come you're still struggling in that area or that area? And you can come into that relationship. You can come into that light where God has given us the responsibility. And that's why we also don't believe in just sharing our burdens with everybody. Don't go and dump your load on anybody else. God has ordained where there's an area where He has entrusted spiritual authority. And God has given us not by any virtue of in us, but just because of the calling. He's given us a responsibility to exercise that spiritual authority. And in that context, if you come and bring it into the light, I want you to know it is an area of safety. There is no sin that is brought into the light of Jesus Christ that cannot be cleansed. There is not a single sin that Jesus didn't die for. It doesn't matter how horrible it is. And no matter what the struggle, and no matter how long the struggle is, your safety comes in bringing it into that light and saying, Lord, you've given me these elders. Let them give account for my soul with joy. And I lived for years without that. And I know what it's like. It was like a desert for me, where I didn't have elders who knew the condition of my spiritual walk well, and loved me enough to speak the truth to me and say, brother, if you continue on that journey, you will end up in hell. I wished I had more. Today I do. Today I have accountability with you all. I have accountability with Phil as elders in the church. I have accountability with Zach, where I know that they love me enough that if they see me going astray, and I've opened up my life enough and brought it into the light, where they will speak to me and say, watch out, be careful. That's the kind of relationship we have and we long to have. And we long for that to be the defining factor of this church. That not that we're in the business of, I'll tell you this, I don't have a little, even the slightest bit of lust to know what struggles you're going through. Because I don't want to contaminate myself, but I will never shy away from the responsibility God has given me and the authority He's given me to care for the flock. And my dear brothers and sisters, He's given you that responsibility as well in different areas with your children. Let it be an area of safety where your children can come to you and confide in you and know that Daddy loves me and He's willing to come down to my level, and He Himself is living in submission. He Himself is submitting to the elders in the church, where they don't hear ever from you a word of backbiting or gossip about the elders. You know what that does? It doesn't harm us. If people speak evil about us, it doesn't harm us one bit, I'll tell you that. But it means that in that situation where they try to exercise spiritual authority, they are powerless. And I never want to live that kind of life where I'm trying to fight the devil. And he says, you mean you're trying to exercise spiritual authority over me? And you yourself are not living in spiritual authority? And you speak that way about your boss? And you speak that way about the elders? And you speak that way about this? Where's the spiritual authority going to come from? But thank God, the way of submission is the way of power. The way of submission is a way that's victorious, and it always wins. Jesus proved that. Let me close with this in 1 Peter chapter 5. Likewise, wives, in your submission to your husbands, the devil will convince you. This is the 21st century. I don't have to listen to that garbage. He'll try to tell you that you don't have to submit to your husbands, that husbands, you don't have to submit to your wives as well, like he says in the previous verse. But in that context, recognize this, that it doesn't matter what God allows you to go through, he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able to bear, but with the temptation will give you a way of escape. But in that submission, in that trust of God, read 1 Peter 3, where he talks about Sarah. In that trust of God, he gives you wife. Even if you had an unconverted husband who was an idol worshiper or a terrorist, which is about the worst thing you could call somebody these days, you could be married to such a person, but you have spiritual authority because God sees the way in which you humble yourself and submit yourselves. 1 Peter 5. Verse 5. You younger men likewise be subject to your elders, and all of you clothe yourself with humility toward one another. For God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time. What proper time? Are you looking to be made an elder or to be given this ministry or to be made a king to sit on a throne? No. When the devil comes knocking on your door, he will exalt you. God will exalt you over the devil. That's the proper time I'm interested in. When the devil comes attacking my marriage, at that proper time, I want to have authority where I say, in the name of Jesus, devil, you have no business here. Not in my marriage, not in my home, and not in this church. Verse 7, look at the context now where he now says, now you can cast all your anxiety on him. Casting all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Why should you submit? Because your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour, but resist him firm in your faith. This faith that the centurion had. Knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. Skip back a few pages, James chapter 4. I want you to see that both times in the New Testament where we read about submitting to authority and not exalting ourselves, he talks about spiritual authority over the devil. We saw that in 1 Peter 5. James 4, verse 6. He gives a greater grace. Therefore, it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God. Then resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hand, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be miserable and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. Amen.